hearts open, our minds open, our spirits, and do what you want to do, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I really believe God has a great plan with this church, and I want to just step in and declare over you a word that in this 11th year, I believe as you step over another threshold, that the Lord would want you to increase and multiply. And the Lord would want to bring in more, you know, variety.
A lot more communities are going to come in. I feel the Lord telling you to open up your spirits to welcome people that you may not be familiar with, cultures you may not be used to, and to look at people as they are in the spirit and not as they are in the natural. To stop looking at the external or how people are in, you know, in the natural, but to look in the spirit and to see the people the Lord is going to bring to you. And there will be an increase, I believe, in the name of Jesus. Amen. As you expand yourselves, as you increase your spirits, that the Holy Spirit will bring in, as you increase your capacity to hold more, God will bring more. So just pray and release a blessing for the 11th year, or as you're getting into your 12th, that the Lord will bring much increase as you increase. Amen. I want to touch or continue from where Pastor John left off about our assignment. And you know, God has not sent any one of you here without a purpose. He has marked every single one of us with an assignment from heaven. And we are not called to build our own kingdoms or our own little homes and families. We are called to build the kingdom of God. Amen. And until we find our place in the kingdom, we are restless and we are dissatisfied. And one of God's greatest ways to work and operate is through the family. And I'm just going to touch on the role of the family. I know it may seem boring because, you know, you've heard that, you know, the family is the basic unit and the families have to go well. But if you look at how God operates, God always works in and through families. His very first institution was the family, yes? Adam and Eve, he brings them together and he establishes them and says, become a family and together rule and have dominion on the earth. And he calls himself the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And he works through generations. I know the genealogies are some of the most boring parts of the Bible, yes? Most of us have no problem skipping those chapters. They're like, oh, there's nothing in this. It's just boring genealogy. But do you know how important that is to God? The son of this man, the son of this man, the son of this man. Why? Because God was passing something on through the generations. And he was watching over that thing that he was passing down. And families are so important to God to work through. We, all of us, are a result of something that was passed down through many generations. I am not everything I just decided to be. I didn't pick my family. I didn't pick where I was going to be born or how I was going to be raised up. But everything I am today is a result of things that came down to me from the generation. Some good, some not so good. But God is not limited by what I have inherited. Because he is called the father of all families. Amen. He puts a child into a home or into a setting that can be risky, can be abusive, can be good, can be not so good. But he knows that he is the father of all. And whatever situation or circumstance that child grows up with, as when that child, if that child encounters him as the perfect father, he can push that child back into his destiny. Amen. So God is not limited by your background, by your family, by what your father did to you, by what your mother did to you, or, you know, what your ancestors were like. He's not limited by any of that. And God is the eternal perfect father. And he intends for his church to be a family. And that is why Jesus himself came, you know, to reveal the Father. He didn't come to tell you what God was like. He came to tell you what the Father was like. He came to show you that you've got God all wrong, show all of us. That you think God is all about do's and don'ts and a lot of laws and religion, but that's not who he is. I want to show you who my Father really is. So God's intent with man from the very beginning was to be Father and to create this family of people that would carry his heart and his nature and his mandate. When he made Adam, Adam is called the Son of God. In Luke 3, verse 38, you've seen the genealogy of Jesus. It talks about, you know, all of Jesus' ancestors. And finally comes to Adam and says, and Adam, the Son of God, which means Adam, God created Adam to be a father to him. And God gave him a mandate. Adam, be fruitful, multiply, increase, and rule and have dominion. That was the father's mandate, the king's mandate for his sons. And that mandate is passed down to every seed of Adam. If we are children of Adam, the human race, we have that same mandate on us. And we are also the sons of God. Amen. And we have the mandate from heaven that says, be fruitful, increase, multiply, rule, have dominion. Every one of you in this room has that mandate on you. That God would tell you, whatever you're doing, you think is a little, God says, be fruitful. Multiply it. Increase it. Maybe your business. Maybe your what you're doing in your workplace. Maybe your church. Whatever you are doing, the DNA inside you is the DNA for increase. Amen. The genetic code God has put in you has the potential to increase, to multiply, to rule, and to have dominion. Sons of God, say amen. 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 That is who you are. That is what we are created to be. The everything inside you has that potential. I can increase. I'm not talking about increasing your size, your girth. Okay, that is another increase. We're talking about increasing in the spirit. And if you have a desire that, oh, I must grow this, I must get more or get bigger, that is a God-given desire inside of you. But what happens is the enemy steals that desire and uses it to build your own thing, your own kingdom, your own agenda, your own ambition, while it was given to you to establish God's kingdom here on earth. And when man takes the mandate but misuses the mandate of God, man went away in sin. And God had to send his son back, his son onto the earth to show us what the original plan was. And Jesus came saying, okay, mankind has got it all wrong. I need to show them who the Father is, and I need to show them what they are called to do. What is the purpose with which I sent them, with which I created them? What is the mandate that I want to give them? And when Jesus came, the one thing he kept going on about was his relationship with his Father. You know, we talked about fulfilling the assignment of God on our lives. And I know that has stirred up in many of us just the fact that I have an assignment. I'm not just here to do life and, you know, just have kids and get them married and then get, you know, pray that they get jobs and then grow old and die. No. Every single one of us has a purpose. It may be raising your two children, but that if you do it with a purpose, knowing it is a purpose of God, you will do it differently. If you think it is all that I'm doing, you do it differently. If I believe that this is my God-given mandate, this is my God-given purpose, this is my role in the kingdom, I do it with all my heart, and I seek God about how I can do it. You know, none of us can fulfill God's mandate without intimacy with the Father. Jesus couldn't do it without intimacy with the Father. How did Jesus do everything he had to do on earth? I do what I see my Father do. I say what I hear my Father speak. I do nothing of myself. I will only do what he does. And that is the way it is meant to be. Every one of us in an intimate relationship with the Father, you get your assignment. It is not going to come from pastor. It is not going to come from your care cell leader. It will only come in the secret place when you sit with God and you ask Him, Lord, what is my assignment? What is my purpose here? Am I just meant to be doing what I'm doing, or do you have more for me? Jesus got it in the secret place. Jesus got it when He sat with the Father. And how do you fulfill your assignment? You fulfill it by walking in intimacy with the Father. Jesus could not do anything He did without the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, we think that Jesus did everything He did because He was the Son of God. But the truth is, now this is a very radical thing that I'm going to say here. The truth is that Jesus left all of His Godhead in heaven when He came to earth. He brought nothing of His God nature down with Him. When He was born on earth, He was completely man, without sin. Which means everything He did was the basic model for what man was supposed to be like. If He healed, that was because God had given man that kind of an authority on the earth. If He could control the winds and the waves, that was because Adam, the Son of God, was meant to walk in that kind of authority. But sin was what destroyed the purpose that God had for man. When Jesus was filled with the Holy Spirit, everything He did is what you and I are called able to do when we are filled with the Holy Spirit. How many tongue talkers here? How many of you pray in tongues? Yes? Which means if you pray in tongues, you are empowered to do everything that Jesus did. Amen. We are not filled with the Holy Spirit to come and speak in tongues a few minutes every Sunday morning. So if we are not pursuing the Jesus life, everything that Jesus did, that is my basic normal for life. That must be my, you know, that's where we start. Which is why He said in John 14, the works that I do, you will do also. But He said, not just what I do, greater works than what I do, you will do. Because I'm going to the Father, my time's up. But I leave the Holy Spirit with you. And He in you empowers you to do far greater than I could ever do. We have to have another paradigm, another way of thinking. Our idea of normal is not normal, is not God's idea of normal. God's idea of normal is the Jesus life. If we're not doing the Jesus life, I got to figure out, Lord, what's wrong? If the demons are not trembling when we are there, we have to ask, what's wrong? When the disciples could not cast out demons, they went back to Jesus and asked Him, why couldn't we do it? When we fail to cast out demons, we will theologize it and say, no, that demon is a different demon, or, you know, that person is not ready, or that person is not willing, or we try to find our own reasons. But the truth is, we got to get back into the sanctuary and say, Lord, if I'm not walking like You walked, if I'm not doing what You did, then I'm not doing the greater works. Then, Lord, this is not normal. Amen. God has an assignment for every single one of us. The only way we can fulfill it is by walking in intimacy with the Father, getting into the secret place, knowing the presence of God, walking with the Holy Spirit. And that is where you're going to download your assignment. If you want to know what your boss wants from you, you have to sit with the boss, or you have to hear it from somebody, or they have to give it to you. Yes? It's the same with the Father. And the thing is, He gives you one step at a time. He gives you one direction, and then He waits to see how you obey before He gives you the next one. It's an exciting life with God. You know, when I was working till 2015, a nice job in the medical college, I was teaching medical students, and he, of course, involved in the ministry when the Lord said, step out of the boat. walk on the water. That's what he told me. And I thought, I knew it was about leaving the, you know, the steady salary, the, you know, the honor of being in, you know, working in the medical college, etc. And he said, step on the water, walk out of the boat. And when he tells you things like that, it'll take everything in you to obey. And it will search, you know, your heart, it'll search your motives, it'll search your security, because every month you get a paycheck and you know you live off that and you plan according to that because you know that's what's coming every month. Now there's nothing, you know, there's no monthly paycheck. Even he has never taken a salary from the ministry. So my salary would pay the bills off in the home every month. Or so I thought, okay. Till the Lord said, step out of the boat, give up the job and get into, join the ministry. And then I thought, okay, now how am I, you know, what's going to change now that I have to trust every month for, you know, our needs or what all do I have to cut and what all do I have to change and what brands do I not get to buy anymore, you know, all of that. But once I did it and I realized the Lord told me, see, till now you thought this was your source. You looked at them as your source. You forgot that I was your source all along. And now that I stepped out, there was no salary coming from anywhere. I knew that Father is the source. And suddenly my eyes opened to realize, so I was so silly. I was a son of God with all heaven's resources available for me if I walk in obedience to God. There is no limit to my Father's resources. All of heaven is open for someone who walks in obedience. And here I'm living thinking that this boss is my source and wondering what I'm going to do once the boss goes out of the way. For those of you who are working, let me tell you, God is your source. Don't insult God by thinking that your boss or your monthly paycheck is your source. Your eternal Father, who is God of heaven and earth, you know, he has stars spinning around at his word. You know, he plays, like he was saying, he throws balls of gold around that are so big, you know, probably 100 times our planet. And here we are wondering where my next month's paycheck is going to come from or where my visa is going to get fixed. Come on, big, think big, sons of God. Think like sons of God. Amen. Think like the children of God. You know, Jesus, when he came down, he didn't ask God, I need few bars of gold in my pocket as a baby in the cradle. Why? Because I'm going to earth. I need some pocket money. I need some extra superpowers just in case those guys don't listen to me. He came with nothing. The only thing he had when he came down as a baby was his relationship with his Father. Amen. If you have a relationship with God, if you have an intimacy with the Father, that is all you need, sons of God. And when he commanded the winds and the waves, they go down. When he commands the demons, they are out. When he speaks to the sicknesses, they disappear. That's what the sons of God are meant to do. Amen. We have to change the paradigm. Change your thinking. Know who you are. Know where you're coming from. Know that God has sent you. You have not come here because your parents wanted you or didn't want you. You came here because God sent you and God sent you with a purpose. If you have your relationship with God, in that you have everything you need. Amen. God works in and through families, and the family is next to your relationship with God. Your relationship in the home is the most important way in which God is going to operate in your lives. And, you know, we see a lot of men and women of God. We shepherd people, a lot of pastors and their wives come to us with problems they have at home. And we realize that people can preach powerful messages, you know, on TV, and they can go around the world just preaching the gospel. There are thousands turning to the Lord through them. But behind the scenes, their homes are a wreck. Their children are not being fathered. And we realize that this is the enemy's plan to destroy a generation. While God is a God who works through families, He is a generational God. He is interested, you know, if He wasn't, you would not have so many chapters on genealogy. He calls Himself, like I said, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. I am with you generation after generation after generation. And when God calls Abraham, if you look in the book of Genesis, now one of the reasons that God honored Abraham was because Abraham had such a heart to train his children. Yeah, if, let me just get that scripture. Okay, Genesis 18, verse 17. Okay, the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I have chosen him that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has promised him. It says, I chose him that he may command his children and his household after him, so that I can bring upon him everything that I promised him. See, the family unit is the most powerful force that God has placed on the earth. A family that, see, it was God's intent when he brought man and woman together. His word over them was the two will become one. And in that oneness, God saw great power. You know, what happens in marriage is that often we come to the place of where our goal in marriage is maintaining peace. We figure out over the years how I can live with my husband or wife in a way that there are no fights. And peace is my goal. Don't fight. If I say this, he gets upset. If she says that, he gets upset. So you do a very careful maneuvering through life. And the goal is peace, no fights. Stay out of my way. I stay out of your way. We do life together. We go to church. We preach the gospel. We do the ministry. And there's peace at home. We have no major fights. We have no major challenges. But the goal that God wanted marriage to have was the goal of becoming one. Now that is way harder. It's easier to maintain peace. You can figure out over after a couple of years how to maintain peace. But is that God's goal for the family, for your marriages? We will talk about more of this tomorrow in the marriage seminar. But just for the taster, if you think that the marriage is great, often, you know, I think men are more happy when there is peace at home. At one of our anniversaries, I can't remember which one. Do you remember which one? Maybe 10th or 12th? I think maybe the 10th. So he was celebrating, oh, what a great marriage we have. Well, I was thinking, how can we make it better? The typical woman. Yeah. So then he says, see, we have such an amazing marriage that most couples don't have such, you know, such a great marriage. And I say, so we're going to stay here the rest of our life? You know, is this where we're going to be? And here I am, the school teacher, saying, we have to look at how to get better, you know? We have to keep bettering the marriage. So, and then we realized that day that both of us saw things from a very different perspective. While the man was happy, I have a wife, we don't fight, I haven't beaten her up, she's broadly, you know, not manipulating, we are happy, life is good. Well, here I am, the woman, thinking, life is good, but how's it going to get better? What can we do to make it better, you know? So we realized that day that, okay, we want to keep working on it. And I think every couple must never come to a place where you settle down and you stop intentionally working and building the family, building on the marriage. We must always challenge yourself to think, this is good, but are we truly one? Because you can always get closer to being one. The power in the marriage is when the two become one. They become this indefeatable force together. And God knows that. God knows that if they can stand together with one heart, one vision, one purpose, leaving behind their selfish agendas, leaving behind, I want this and I want that, leaving behind their rights and their opinions, laying it down for the what? For the sake and the goal. No, we are one. They will become an indestructible force for the enemy. The enemy cannot stand against a family like that. And in the oneness of the parents, of the husband and wife, is where the children are supposed to grow up. And as the children grow up between a husband and wife that are one, the child receives his or her identity, receives his or her purpose in God. Now, this is the ideal. We are all working towards this, but ground reality, all of us have a difficult time becoming one, including us. It is a constant denying yourself. It is a constant dying to self if you have to become one. But we keep this goal before us. When I want my way and he wants his, we have to decide, okay, which is more important? It's more important to be one. We don't always do it. There are times we mess up. There are times we fail. Let me be honest. Because saying it is one thing, but I have realized it takes everything. The goal of becoming one is intended by God to learn, to teach us to deny ourselves. Because we can be content with the peace goal. You know, both of us are happy. You never have to deny yourself that way. But the Christian walk is about learning to become like Christ. And if you want to become like Christ, that means the cross is the way. Yeah? So this is God's way. Why? Because every other relationship, I can decide to keep you out. But in the relationships at home, in the family, the marriage, the children, I can't run away from that relationship. Right? It is going to expose everything in me. Even parenting. Let me just touch on parenting. You know, most of us think that our goal as parents is to raise up good children. What would you think of some other goals as parents? What does God want us to do? Let me hear your thoughts. Go for it. Bring up our children in God's ways. Anything else? What are we doing in our parenting? Sorry? Give them a good education. Anything else? Train them. Train them in godly ways. You know, everyone, once they get married, they want to have children. After a while, if you don't have children, it is a problem in society, right? Like he was saying, you know, the aunties and the grandmas will come after you. So maybe just to keep them happy, some of us have children. But there is an intrinsic desire in every human being, again, because of the word of God that said, be fruitful and multiply. That's God's word in you. So it's a natural desire that we want to have children. Now, once we have children, we usually just let them grow. We feed them. We give them what we think is good for them. We clothe them. We try to send them to the best schools. We try to give them, you know, the best possible education. We save up for their college. We try to send them to the best places. And we think that we're supposed to make sure they get a great job and make a lot of money. Right? This is broadly the idea of parenting that most people have. Now, what was God's idea? God's idea was that in every home, children would grow in a safe place, under a father and a mother that display the love of God, that walk in the relationship that God the Father has with his children. And through that, raise up another generation like him. And they go out, raise up another family again like him and replicate the heavenly family. God is a family. God is a father. And Jesus is the Son of God. Again, you see family operating there. And the goal of our families is actually to display God's love. In the husband and wife relationship, the most important thing that will that you keep as the, you know, the center place is to walk in unconditional agape love. And the goal in parenting, again, what we have, you know, realized over the years, or what we use in our parenting, is our goal as parents is to model Christ to them as much as we are able to. It's not always easy because the kids hear all our messages, and when we say things like this and we don't do it, they come back to us and say, "Mama, you're not really modeling Christ there. You're the one who told me last, you know, who shared in the last message that this was how we're supposed to do it." As parents, our goal is to display to the children what Christ is like, which means your children are supposed to look at you and see what Jesus is like. And we as parents are supposed to raise them up to a place where they have a communion and a relationship with God. Train them not just in their behavior, but train, see what's happening inside their hearts. Often people, parents come to us saying, "Pastor, my son is, you know, going after games and this and that. You need to fix him." Especially teenage parents. You know, parents of teenagers. "You need to fix my son. You need to talk to him." And we're like, how are we going to, you know, talk to this teenager whom they have had in their home for 14, 15 odd years and give us like 2 hours to fix the boy or fix the girl? Yeah, how many of you know parents like that, that need some help? Or maybe you are in that place. You know, that you have a teenager at home and you don't know what to do with the teenager. And I often think we don't, most of us, as when we start, we're not sure of what am I supposed to do with this child. And we raise them up till they're 14, and one fine day we realize that, oh, the child is not under my control anymore. You know, parenting is another whole journey. And God has a plan and a purpose in our parenting. I believe parents must start way earlier. We wake up to the reality when they're 14, but we need to actually start when they're little. Start building a relationship with them. Start understanding what's happening with their lives. Start praying for them. Start praying with them. You know, our goal with our children is to make sure they have an encounter with God. I think for me, that is the greatest goal of my parenting. They must encounter God. And everything I do and say can be a hindrance to that or can help that. If I'm yelling, I just made it that much harder for my child to encounter Christ. If I'm not displaying the love of God, when I tell them, "Jesus loves you, God will always hear your prayer, God will always answer your prayer," I am creating a, "Oh, but Mama is like this, she says God is like this." No, I am supposed to display Christ to them in everything I do and say. Which means, who changes in parenting? We do. We have to change. We have to change in marriage. We have to change in parenting. We have to change by humbling down. How many of you have ever apologized to your children? It kills you. You know, it kills you to go to a 6-year-old or a 7-year-old and say, "Mama was wrong. I'm sorry. I lost my temper. That was not right. I need help. Please pray for me." It takes a lot of courage to do that. If you haven't tried, let me encourage you to try that. Because parenting changes you, marriage changes you. And there is no way that we can fulfill our God-given assignment without God actually dealing with what's happening in the home. You know, I personally know the wife of a man of God who does meetings 365 days of the year. And the wife tells me that there is a euphoria in ministering and preaching to thousands. But when you come off that stage, you come to the place where you get down to real life. And that is painful. Where you have to face your husband, you have to face your wife, you have to handle your children, you have to change nappies, and you have to, you know, you have to do the dishes and clean the home. Where that is painful. So to avoid that, the ministry is euphoric. So he makes sure that he's engaging himself 24/7 in the ministry. Why? So I don't have to come back and face all this. But that is not the kind of God we serve. God is a God of families. He wants you to go into the family and work on those relationships. Work on your relationship with your wife. Work on your relationship with your children. Deny yourself like he did. Jesus didn't have to come to earth to face all this mess. He could have sat up there and said, throw them all into hell. Yeah? But why? God is a family. How can he, the father of the family, resign the whole family into destruction? So he got involved in the mess. If our father would do that, he requires every one of us to do that. To be intentional about what's happening in my home. To be praying for the home. To be thinking of, to be intentional about your parenting. To understand where you're, what's happening with the child. You know, in my times of prayer, the Holy Spirit has shown me some things about the children that I would never have seen. I would have just missed, and I know I would have destroyed the child. For example, let me just, share vulnerably about some things. When my older daughter was in her first grade, I started teaching her. For those moms who are teaching your children, especially, you know, the ones that don't like to sit and don't like to learn. So naturally, like all mothers, when you teach them and you send them for the exam, you expect them to get full marks and come back, yeah? Because I taught you all of this. But that does not always happen, yeah? So what happens is we start losing our temper over the children. Or when I call you to sit and study, you sit and you study. And you sit till you finish it, till you've got it, and till you're, you know, and oh my goodness, me and my little one would have wars in the home. They'll be crying and yelling. And, you know, that time is nobody in the home says anything. It's very quiet except for me and my poor child. She will come every time and she knows it's going to be, you know, warfare time. But willingly, like a lamb to the slaughter, she would come every time to sit. And I would have gone on that role, you know. I think, and I watch moms do that today. If it wasn't for the Lord who intervened with me, in my times of prayer, the first thing that comes up is my relationship with my child. And I'm like, Lord, I'm talking about the nations and we're talking about revival and God does not want to listen to anything. I'm trying to get past, you know, all of that. But there is only one thing the Holy Spirit wants to deal with, and that is my relationship with my child. So I have to get down to say, what's happening? The Lord says, you are not displaying me. You are not representing me. You are not showing her what I'm like. So I'm like, okay, this is going to get deep. Over the next months, I started rewiring my brain. Because this is the way that I always, you know, this is the way that I grew up with. And I started rewiring myself saying, I am supposed to display Jesus to them. Which means if she does poorly at school and she comes to Jesus, what would Jesus say? If she's, you know, having a bad day and she comes to Jesus, how would Jesus respond? I have no right to respond in any other way but the way Christ would. And that wrecked me because I wasn't there. And I prayed over the next couple of months. I said, okay, Lord, because the Lord said, today you say, you know, you tell her that Jesus loves her and then you're yelling and screaming and then when she doesn't believe in Jesus, you'll be the reason because you haven't displayed him. You haven't shown her. You haven't shown, I gave you this baby for what? I want you to display my nature. I want you to show this child what I'm like. So in my words, in my actions, in everything I do, I am called to display him. So for me, that made parenting very easy. My goal is what? To display Christ to them. And what am I looking for? I'm looking to connect them to the Heavenly Father. You're not looking at making billionaires or doctors or engineers. God has a goal way beyond that. My little one loves football. He has been talking about football for the past couple of years. We ignored it. I mean, of course, I don't think there is a boy here that isn't probably talking about football. But a couple of months ago, the Lord told me, start praying with him. So we, in family prayer, once in a while, we pray for his football dream. You know, I say, Lord, if it is your will that he does football, we want to pray it. How do I know what God has for him? How do I know God wants him to become a doctor or an engineer? What if God wants him to become a footballer? Who am I to quash that dream? We are just given these children as to steward them, to become what God wants them to become, not to become what we want them to be. Amen. So I have to give account for my parenting. I have to go back and tell God what I did with the two that he gave me. So my job is to represent Christ. And I stepped back with that. And I began to change my whole way of dealing with my child. And I came to the place of telling her, I want you to work hard. I want you to sit and study 2 hours. However little you get done in that 2 hours is fine. You go for the exam. Whatever you do, however much you get, is not an issue. I'm happy. And it took her a little time to start believing that I wouldn't yell. But I trained myself and, you know, stopped. My yardstick changed. If you studied 2 hours and you went for the exam, you get 0 out of 50, I celebrate. I'm good. Why? Because I'm not training you to get 100 out of 100. I'm training you to work hard. And I realized that her brain may have been a little different, maybe slow. Maybe another child can get 100 out of 100, but God created her differently. So let me celebrate that. And she loves music and she loves, you know, to play the keys and to sing. So maybe that's the gifting God has given her. And let me work with that. The foundation of the kingdom is the family. We are talking about changing the world, but God is interested in the inside, what's happening on the inside. He is interested in how families are being shepherded. Every single one of us, parents, husbands and wives, fathers and mothers, you are pastors in your home. You are the shepherds of your family. What you expect your pastor to do with you is what God expects you to do with your children. Imagine every family unit being shepherded like that. My goal with these children is to make them disciples. Just like pastor's goal with the church is to make disciples of every one of us. Now, every parent took on the challenge to make disciples of their two. How much easier the job is for the pastor. And then, see, this is God's hierarchy. This is God's great plan. Every one of us taking ownership for my zone. And I tell, Pastor, you know, we do discipleship schools all around the world. And we are, you know, our passion is making disciples. Even in church, we are like disciples. We are not satisfied with seats being filled. You know, the other day we are again praying for an increase. But our hall is getting filled up. And the Holy Spirit told me, don't be happy just because numbers are being filled up. He's like, when the trumpet sounds, it's the disciples that are going to go up. He's like, you have to give account for those seats that were filled, but they weren't made disciples. So then our whole focus, because we were getting excited every week with the graph going up or the numbers increasing. People are hearing about the church. People are coming to church. The Holy Spirit burst that bubble for me. Don't be excited with the numbers. Be excited when disciples are being made. Because when the Lord comes, it's the disciples that are going to go up. Amen. So we are now, you know, we're like, okay, we must train. We must train our 300. We must make them disciples. We can't be happy with them just coming and going. No, that's not what God is excited about. We must look at getting deeper, which means we must look at making them better fathers and better mothers and teach them and train them all to be shepherds in their families, shepherds in their workplaces. You know, we have people working in the IT parks and we tell them, you are the shepherds there. Be the pastor, the people around you. Love them. Be whatever you want pastor to be there where pastor can't reach. And it begins, and the home and the family is the building brick for the kingdom of God. This is where the shaping happens. This is where the molding happens. Right? What is God's, quickly to just run through, God's purpose in the family? Definitely one is communion and companionship. God said it is not good for man to be alone. Yes? That's why he has placed you in a family. If you're not having communion or companionship in the family, something is wrong. Some of us want to run away from our families. We don't want to go home because home is a painful place to be. That is not God's desire. And fathers, let me urge you, it is the father's role to decide the environment of the family. God has placed on you the responsibility to decide what the family is going to look like, to set the standard for the home. The husband is the head of the home, which means the husband is supposed to set the standard. This is the standard for our home. This goes, this does not go. This is yes, and this is no. And it is also his job to enforce that standard. Now, a husband or a father that is not doing his job can make the home a mess. So there is a greater responsibility, but there is also greater grace for the fathers who are thinking, oh my goodness, how am I going to get my wife and kids under control? There is grace on you. Look to the Heavenly Father. He will give you your strategy. He will give you wisdom to do what you need to do in your home. So communion and companionship must be there in every home. Your children must want to come home. Your children must have companionship in the home. You must not always be telling them to go read and go study or sit quiet or, you know. The children must be able to, are your children enjoying family time? You know, we make it a point to have family time. Everything tries to squeeze out our family time. There'll be prayers, there'll be people in need. We have to fight for time with the family, especially being in the ministry. And we feel happy that we're doing the ministry thinking that it'll make up. It'll make up for time with the children, but it doesn't. You have to fight for your time with the kids. It is okay to say no to some things if the kids need you. Okay? It's not very spiritual, but if you have to invest, you know, into time with the children. And sometimes all the kids need is to, you know, play a game of Monopoly with them. They're thrilled, they're excited. But you just invested some time into relationship with them. Tomorrow when they're going through a difficult time, they need to know they can come to you. When they come with little stuff and we react and we yell or we, you know, for example, they come with some questions. Children, when they're growing up, they'll have strange questions that you may not be ready to answer yet. How do babies come? Or what happens? Why are they having a baby? They're not married. How can men, you know, all these weird questions that we don't want to really answer for the kids. When you grow up, you'll find out. We had, you know, our phase of, you know, those kind of questions. And we had to prayerfully decide, okay, this is the time. We need to talk about some of these things. Why? Because if I'm not giving them answers here, they're going to get their answers from the wrong places. Not just that, they know mom can't handle these questions. Mom gets, you know, mom panics or dad gets angry when we ask these questions. So they know, don't go anywhere near them with these. Go to friends. They can handle it. They give you better answers. So parents, grow up. Seriously, grow up to handle yourself, to handle your kids. At some point, you got to know that, you know, we want to keep them at 3 years and 4 years where everything we tell them is, you know, gospel truth. But they're growing up. By 8, 10, they realize, oh, everything mom said wasn't right. Or everything dad said, you know, my dad told me you turn the light on in the car, the cops will catch you. And I believed it for a very long time. My mom told me you eat the seed of the apple tree grows inside. I believed it for a very long time. Till you finally wake up to the truth that was not true. You know? And then you realize, then what about all the other things that they told me? Probably not true either. And that's when you start questioning a lot of things that they tell you. And we parents are slow to wake up to the fact that all this is happening in their head. And by the time they're 14, 15, they're suddenly rebelling. And we think it is sudden. But it wasn't that sudden. It's just that we missed a lot of signs that were being shown while they were growing up. We were stifling the signs. Be quiet. Don't ask things like that. Don't talk like that. Da, da, da. We were not able to go in and say, what is happening inside his mind? What is happening inside his heart? Take it to the Lord in prayer. We have had months on our knees. You know, there have been difficult times, painful times. We take it to the Lord. Say, God, give us grace to parent. We don't know how to do this. So we think we can always keep them, you know, stifled. But that doesn't happen. So as parents, we have to grow up. We have to be wise. Amen. Just like Jesus spent time with his disciples and he discipled them. We have to come to the place of discipling them, where they come up with us and we are able to talk about Christ to them. You know, our daughter had this phase where she was questioning things. And it was a natural thing. Why? Because when they go to school, they see all, you know, different kind of stuff. They come home and they're in this church world where, you know, everything is, we don't allow anything else, yeah. So she had her questions. She said, is Jesus really the way? How can we be so sure? And, you know, all of those questions. So the natural temptation is, no, you must believe. Jesus is the only way. But Pastor actually took time to walk her through apologetics. They listened to some Ravi Zacharias. He started reasoning out with her, apologetically, intelligently. And he did his homework, researched. Why? Because this was a time we could not afford to stifle those questions. We had to deal with them. Why? Because we're discipling. My intention is to make a disciple out of her, not to make someone that does everything I tell them to do. So we got a signal that there are questions inside. We got to deal with it. Sometimes you don't have all the answers. You got to pray. Maybe go in a fast or whatever. But trust the Lord with that. Thankfully, she came out of that season. And soon after that, she said, I want to take baptism. I want to follow Christ. That may or may not be everybody's story. But the heart of, you know, to know the heart of the child. We are not just, don't just correct behavior. Sit down, stand up, sit like this, do that. You got to understand what's happening inside the heart. That is discipling. If Jesus was, you know, what happened in the Old Testament was that. Do these laws, do these, this external behavior was corrected. But Jesus came in the New Testament and said, no, I'm dealing with what's happening on the inside. You can tithe, you can do this, you can offer sacrifices, but I'm not pleased with that. I want to know what's happening inside your heart. Right, so the family is meant to be a place of communion for the children, companionship. Children must want to be with the parents, you know, to hang out. If they're not desiring that, find out what's happening. Get into their world. Most parents want the children to come along, you know, we drag them for all our meetings and all our, you know, whatever. We need to get into their world once in a while. We need to go and play ball with them. We need to, you know, go and do what they're doing. It's okay, nothing will happen to us. You know, for the first time we watched our son playing football. It was so exciting to, you know, sit there and cheer for him. Get into their world, you know, and don't always just expect them to fit into yours. The family is meant to be a help in need. Anyone is going through a need, the family is the place that we find help in. That is God's design. If you're going anywhere else other than your husband or your wife for help, that's not the way God intended it to be. The family is the place where you're going to deal with your selfishness. You cannot stay selfish in a home. After we got married, both of us very different. He is extremely organized. I'm not. His table is perfect order. Mine will have broadly everything I need on it. So after we got married, we had just one table in the house. So you can imagine, it was all my table and it was all his table. So he made a line. He said, this is your side, this is my side. You don't touch my side. Don't even put, you know, even one strand of hair on his side. He would get upset. You know, then one auntie had to come and rebuke him and said, once you're married, the two are one, which means the table is for both of you. You can't say my table, your table. You know, so I was happy. I was like, yes, that's it. So then, you know, it was, and it, for him, it was a dying to self. He had to die to his need to have his table immaculate. Today, very wisely, in our home, we have two separate tables on two ends of the room. You know, he faces there, I face here, so we can, you know, both of us focus on our, you know, study of whatever we're doing. But the early days, this is a small example. There were way bigger examples of dying to yourself. But I have to say no to what I want, and this is the way I like it, and this is the way I do it. That has to go. And marriage and the family is the perfect place for God to do that. Where else can God get you to deny yourself, right? The God's intent is to deal with the selfishness in your heart. The family is meant to model Christ. Parents, your children must see you and see Christ. We are not perfect. But we tell them that. We tell them, see, we are on our journey to become like Jesus. And we mess up. Forgive us. Pray for us. When they were littler, they would take everything far more, you know, mom said that, dad said that. Now they start questioning us, you know. But this is not what you preached. Mama, you said, you know, especially when we have an argument, we cannot have a peaceful argument when the kids are there. We want to let it out, you know, we want to express ourselves, but we have to be under control, watch the decibels, you know, watch the language, watch the emotion, because if they're sitting there, so we just wait to just go somewhere and, you know, express ourselves the way we want to. The children are growing up and they're watching. And so if I am not allowing myself to be changed or allowing the, you know, what the impression I'm making on them must affect me. It must make me change. And if I have made a mistake, humble down. Say I'm sorry. There are times I yell at the children for maybe I think they did something wrong and later I found out that it wasn't their fault or they didn't do it. I misunderstood. I have to go back and say that was wrong. My tone was wrong. What I said was wrong. Please forgive me. And I make it a point to work on it. I tell myself I cannot excuse myself for behaving like that. I am modeling Christ. Amen. So the home is meant to be a model of Christ. Those that don't know Christ must see your home and see the love of God in there. The family is meant to raise a godly generation. Children growing up in a safe place where Christ is modeled will grow up secure with a strong identity, right? So they will become godly. You will not need to just train their behavior if you can get their heart. If you can influence their heart to love Jesus, their behavior will change automatically. For children growing up in church, the thing is we try to change their behavior. Sit like this, stand like this, do that. You know, prayer time, act like this. Not prayer time, act anyway. You know, we must not be just intent on changing external behavior, but to be interested in what's happening in their heart. The family is meant to raise a godly generation. The family is meant to reveal the sons of God through the home. Who are the sons of God is meant to be revealed as a loving husband and wife that love Jesus and are following Christ, are becoming disciples. When they raise up children, they will raise up children to be like Christ. Through that, we display the sons of God. And through that, we build the kingdom of God on earth. When the disciples asked Jesus, where is the kingdom? They said, when is it going to come? Is it going to come from here? Is it going to come from there? Jesus said, the kingdom is inside you. He said, don't look here and there. Don't look up and don't look there. Why? They were waiting for mighty angels and armies to come. When is the kingdom going to come? He said, that's not how I am building this kingdom. I'm building this kingdom one person at a time. I'm changing your hearts. I'm changing your belief systems, one family at a time, one home at a time, and through that, I will increase my kingdom. So it is not just about every one of us doing it alone, but it is every one of us doing it as families, and through families, doing it in this big family, the church family, and many church families in a city together impacting the city. Many cities impacting the nation. And that is how he increases his kingdom. He's not looking at, you know, coming from heaven and, you know, showing a superstar. That's not how he does it. This is the more difficult way. One heart at a time. One heart at a time. Change each one. Then change the family. Then through the family, build the church. Through the church, build the city. Transform the city. Through the cities, transform the nation. Through the nation, transform the world. Amen. That is God's agenda. And it has to begin with your individual walk with God and your intentionality about your family. Once you're a family on a mission, begin to get involved in the church. Increase the influence of your family. Together as a family, partner with the pastors, partner with the church, and let us see Dubai transformed. Yeah? Amen. Shall we pray and close? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this amazing time. We thank you for your plan I thank you for the wonderful people that are here. I thank you for every heart that you're stirring up. I pray, Lord, especially for the young people here, Lord. I believe that you will bring in, Lord, a lot of young families. And Father, pray that through them, you will realign, Lord. You will realign them to heaven's agenda, Lord. Heaven's vision for families. Lord, heaven's vision for homes and husbands and wives and children. Growing up in safe places. Growing up in heaven's environment. In heaven's, Lord, in heavenly atmospheres. Yes, Lord, I believe that. I believe as husbands and wives begin to pray together and begin to love one another, the atmosphere in homes are going to change. Yes, Lord, I just pray against every work of the enemy, Lord, against families in this church. I just pray the grace of God to be released over every home, over every father, Lord, that is trying to set up standards of heaven here, Lord. I pray, let the standards go up, Lord. Let the standards rise. Let the fathers, Lord, begin to seek your face and let there be a realigning, Lord, in every home. Realigning, Lord. Realigning with God. And let the atmospheres in the homes just begin to be transformed. I pray every home to be heaven on earth. Every home to have the glory of God in them, Father. Every home to display the love of God. Pray against every attack, Lord, over the homes. Pray against the strategies of the enemy. We want to expose them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We want to expose every plan of the enemy to destroy homes, to cause strife and contention, to cause bitterness and unforgiveness. We pray against that, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we just release the presence of the Holy Spirit, the wisdom of God, upon every home, Father. Every home, every home. Walk in a new anointing, in a new blessing of God. I thank you. Give you glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen.